All right. Once again, good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everybody who is on this call. Welcome to the session on the DataWiz simulation. We are proud to launch this new product from Knowlescape. And the whole idea here is to be able to work with data to gain insights and communicate stories around data. So those will be the key themes around the data visualization simulation. And I'm super happy to have a guest speaker today, Max Gabriel, a good friend and a chief transformation officer of Informa Markets. And the actual product launch will be done by the head of products at Knowlescape, Kalyan Maganti. So once again, welcome. Thanks for taking this time. And I want to quickly set the context before we move ahead. That's a product we are going to be launching today called DataWiz. And the agenda for today is the following. We'll start with a quick introduction to Knowlescape. Those of you who are not familiar with this organization, I'd like to quickly get started with a brief introduction of who we are and what we do. And I'm sure you're all waiting to hear some industry perspectives on data visualization. So we've got Max to weigh in on some crucial questions on the topic. And we will do a simulation launch and an actual product walkthrough followed by a Q&A. So that's the agenda for the day. Without much further ado, let me jump into introduction to Knowlescape. So there is a deep talent crisis today in the context of digital transformation. And we're all familiar with this, right? More than 52% of companies on the Fortune 500 list have disappeared from that list since the year 2000. So this is more than anything a talent crisis. And traditional learning models are falling short in the digital age. We need a breakthrough approach that accelerates employee transformation and builds digital mindsets at scale. That's the mission at Knowlescape. We are in the business of creating future-ready employees through experiential learning. And our approach has been widely regarded in the industry by Brandon Hall, Burson by Deloitte, and we are a global top 20 gamification company recognized by trainingindustry.com. We are a great place to work as well. So essentially, it's a two-part approach. The first one is for the learner. The great value proposition that we bring to the table here is that we create immersive learning experience for the learner and help them build confidence and capabilities across multiple competencies. And for organizations, we deliver these programs at scale, and we provide in-depth talent analytics through a cutting-edge talent intelligence platform. So that's how we solve the digital talent crisis. And there are two major solution areas we look at in terms of building future-ready talent. The first one is called Leading Now, and the other is called Leading Next. Leading Now is primarily for accelerating leadership transformation. And when I say leaders, this is for individuals, managers, all the way to senior leaders inside organizations, where we focus on 100 plus behavioral, business, and leadership competencies. And Leading Next is for building digital mindsets, where we have a portfolio of future-focused learning products and journeys to build digital mindsets, skill sets, and culture. These are some of the organizations that we have worked with in the past that have adopted the digital blur methodology, one way or the other, where we help them build digital awareness, digital ways of working, be it design thinking, agile, database decision making. It could be digital leadership, digital change championing, and so on. So rich experience across industries and industries when it comes to building digital talent. So that's the portfolio of simulations I was talking about. We have a large library of simulations spanning Leading Now and Leading Next. You will find the more familiar construct of leading self, teams, others, and so on. So there are products here which will help you become great team leaders, great change leaders, change champions, critical thinkers, and so on. So today we'll be adding another product to this portfolio, which is around data visualization. Each one of these products actually generates a report which runs into great detail, 15, 20 page worth of insights that are packed into this report, which lays out in threadbare detail the red, amber, green on multiple competencies. So this helps leaders gain insights on their readiness levels on various topics, provides organizations an understanding of leaders' engagement levels, performance, and potential. And we also provide benchmarking scores across business units, organizations and industries. This is a great value proposition for organizations. So with that quick introduction, without much further ado, I'd like to introduce Max Gabriel to you, Chief Transformation Officer at Informa Markets. Before I do that, I am a big quizzer, right? I'm going to engage you with a little bit of a trivia here. How much did data centers earn in the year 2020 in the context of COVID? Do you have a sense for how much did data centers earn in the year 2020? You can use the chat window and post your answers there. In dollar terms, how much did data centers earn in the year 2020? Okay, feel free to drop your answers on the chat window. And let's make this interactive.
Okay, it was a good business to be in, wasn't it, Roger?
Sorry, Max?
I said it certainly was a good business to be in 2020.
Absolutely, absolutely. So Narendra says $200 billion, Karthik says $100 billion. Any other answers before I reveal the right answer to you? Mona says $100 billion. Okay, so the right answer to this is it is $466 billion. And how much did data consumption grow in the pandemic year? That's in the COVID year compared to the previous year. It grew by 38% and it is still growing, right? So that's the context that I wanted to set before I introduce Max and we can ask him some questions. We are in a world that's generating 77, I don't know how to even say this. It's not megabyte, gigabyte, pentabyte. I don't know what it is, right? It's a humongous amount of data that we are generating every day, right? And the question is, how much of this are we really able to process at work? This reminds me of the Jerry Seinfeld joke where he goes to McDonald's. He sees this caption there saying over 1 billion burgers sold. And he says, that's fine. I'll just have one. Right. So the real question is, what are we doing about it? Right. So there's enormous amounts of data that's being generated. The real question is, how do we visualize this? How do we generate value from this? Right. So, you know, just for starters, data plus information, we know enormous amounts of data getting generated. We know decisions and outcomes have to be generated at the end of this. The missing link here oftentimes is insights and visualization. When 90% of world's information is getting created in the last 2 years, it's imperative that we start visualizing them well and we get to an insight stage before we can take meaningful decisions. So that's the quote that inspires all of us. Storytelling with Data author Cole is talking about having all the information in the world at our fingertips doesn't make it easier to communicate. In fact, it makes it harder, right? The more the information you're dealing with, the more difficult it is to filter. So the ability to visualize, the ability to narrate a story around data is worth its weight in gold. Now, I'd like to introduce Max. You know, we go back a long way when he was in India. I've had the chance to meet with him personally. He's gone from strength to strength, really happy to see his progress. Right now, he is the CTO for Informa Markets, responsible for the company's digital transformation strategy and planning. And he was the CTO at Taylor & Francis, where we did some interesting work around something called Destination Digital to build digital capabilities awareness within the organization. And prior to that, he was the CTO at Pearson India, where he was responsible for the launch of tablet-based learning products in India. And he has been in various senior technology leadership roles at Diageo, Pfizer, JP Morgan, Chase, and so on. And he's a mentor and advisor to several tech startups in the fields of media and education. It's an absolute pleasure to have you with us, Max, for this product launch event. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Roger, pleasure to be here, and thank you for including me. That is quite an intro. I didn't know. You know, when you look at them in a hierarchical order, it does you know, sort of a bit overwhelming. Should we take the slide off so we can have a conversation? Yeah,
absolutely. So I'm going to, you know, I've prepared a few questions for Max. So I'm going to go through this in sequence. So Max, we know that, you know, a lot of information is getting generated, right? And that too in the last few years, IBM data suggests that, you know, 90% of world's information was created in the last 2 years. The interesting part about that is this research came out in 2013. You know, 8 years down the road, I'm pretty sure there's not even 2 years, it's probably a year or lesser, driven by IoT and driven by broadband and multimedia and so on. So can we talk about the importance of data, right? We seem to be generating massive amounts of data. Why should companies care about all of this? Is this noise, which is distracting all of us? Or is there something real?
Yeah, no, I quite like the way you framed it. You know, how data aware are we? And if you look at it on a personal basis and a consumer life and consumer experience day to day, we're reasonably data aware, right? Because subconsciously we're making on a daily basis number of decisions, whether you're looking for a restaurant to go to or you're getting an Uber driver. You know, nobody looks at 2-star rating and say, I wanna take this ride. We are making a lot of data-driven decisions day to day on our personal lives without realizing it. And when you sort of look, when you pause and look at it, you know, this is a result of companies behind these services, products and services, who care enough about it to collect it, organize it, and serve it up in a way that helps you make those decisions. Rather than, you know, if you remember the early days of internet, you know, you were on your own, you know, you were searching for information, you have to figure out what works, and you actually found out what worked or not after having done that. We've evolved quite a bit. And if you look at it from that standpoint, that these are companies that are making it easier for you to consume the product or purchase more or buy more product. You know, Amazon and others are great at it. And Netflix have gotten so good at predicting it where, you know, few seconds within you finish your episode, they start making recommendations, right? So we are subconsciously making plenty of data-driven decisions every day. However, when we come to work, when we come into a professional life, we don't seem to be making that connection. I'm making a general point here, right? We see that as it happens in a consumer, not on the business side. I think that's where, you know, if you do care about your customer, if you do want to make it easier for them to make decisions, we should absolutely take data as the most important thing and actually start caring about it to make it easier for your customer.
Awesome, that's a great response. So there's a valuable insight here as consumers. We seem to get it, we use it, and we are active power users of data on most you know, social media platforms and apps that are out there. But somehow when you come into an organization that we seem to forget the importance of data here. So keeping that, you know, situation in mind where organizations are still falling behind, what does it take to build data literacy in organizations, and what are some common challenges?
Great question. Look, I wish I had a playbook to share with you. We're very much in the early stages of the journey. We are in the process of rolling out a similar program and working with a few partners, including your company, Rajiv, with Nullscape, to craft it in a way. How do we make people more conscious of data? Because that's all it is. It's there, it's all around us, but we don't do enough to make it conscious. What does it take? I think having clarity around why do you need it? You know, it sounds like a pretty obvious statement, but often as we launch these training programs and learning programs, it sounds obvious to us, so we launch it, but we don't take enough time to think about why do we want to do it and what do we want the outcome to look like at the end of it. So I certainly encourage, you know, having clarity around why we want to do it is quite important. And definitely get your top leader of the company or leadership of the company to buy into it and drive it. Because if they don't acknowledge it, if they don't influence it, it's just not going to stick. When I look at common challenges, before I go to the challenges, you know, as we are looking at the program, we're looking at multiple layers. You know, how do you inform and educate the leadership so that they understand the language and the taxonomy? And then you roll it out to the commercial team, so sales, marketing, finance, and HR. What do they need to do differently becoming more data aware or data conscious. That's very important to think about it in those terms of how should the role evolve or get enhanced because of the use of data. A third one is real practitioners on the ground, you know, your data experts. That is all about skill set upgrade. The common challenges in this case is if you make it as a training program, no offense to the training experts there, right? It feels imposed on colleagues. So it just feels like it's been done to them, as opposed to how do you make it really engaging, inspiring, and interactive so that people want to be part of it. You know, running several campaigns about it so the people get involved. You know, what are the data stories you want to talk about? That will get the attention rather than it being a training program that's led by a corporate that everybody must comply. Then you will not get the same level of engagement and application that you would actually benefit from.
Awesome, got it. So from a skills and capabilities perspective, Max, what are some skills and capabilities that individuals, managers, leaders, pretty much everyone in the organization who is dealing with data, what do they have to build to become data savvy?
It's a loaded question here. You know, we talk about data in generality. Everybody understands what it is, but when you ask anyone to explain what data they're talking about, you know, we can't be precise about it because we talk in generalities here. And there's a lot to learn from truly data-driven companies that are out there who is using data to make day-to-day decisions and major business decisions and things like that. Netflix is a great example. In fact, someone was saying they are a data capture company who happen to be in video streaming, right? That's just the way on how they collect data. But if you look at how much data they've gathered about their subscribers, it's just incredible. I would compartmentalize, you know, sort of three broad categories, which is in terms of skill set. There's data analysts skill set, which is not your business analyst repurpose, which is not your financial analyst repurpose. It's a data analyst is a very specific discipline that's starting to emerge. There are plenty of courses out there, and you know, Google relies on it from the ground up. It's a very specific career track. So I would certainly encourage people to look at it as in don't try to repurpose it. This is a skill set that is absolutely needed. Then there's your data engineering group, who is all about how do we capture, process, make it available. That's their job, which is, I think it's a widespread skill set, which are available for sure. The third piece, which traditionally have been called, business intelligence, business analytics, the analytics capability. I think the analytics of yesterday is dramatically different from analytics of today and tomorrow. That is a sophisticated skill set. We can't improvise that. And that's where I think companies need to invest, which I'm pleased to hear, you know, visualization is a huge part of that, Rajiv, as you know. So those three compartments in terms of building the bench strength around that, whether in-house or working with partners to build that will help you understand what do you have and what can you do with it and how do you help make decisions and things like that. And don't make it a, you know, sort of one-off thing. And it doesn't mean it's only for the data team and the experts. If you don't have it, you know, the rest of the organization cannot make meaningful insights out of it. But at the same time, to your previous question, educate the rest of the organization on how do they use data and insight. So both sides of the coin need to work.
Absolutely. It was really well put. In your experience, how does data visualization lead to great business outcomes? Any examples you can think of where complex data got visualized and some business outcomes came out of that? Any personal examples that you can share?
Yeah, this is an important topic because particularly for this session, I started thinking about it because we take it for granted. And data visualization also has a very complex technical aspect to it. It has a technical connotation that it's data and it's dashboards and all of that. But the visualization aspect of it is quite elementary. If you take a step back, right, I was thinking about what is the first visualization I got exposed to? And I thought about solar system, you know. It's incredibly complex topic if you think about it. But if you actually talk to any kid, you know, at a lower grade, they understand solar system, which is a very complex topic, but a beautifully visualized. So people have a very consistent view on, you know, what the universe looks like. You know, it doesn't get that more complicated than that. So visualization plays a huge role in how people are going to consume content, how they're going to consume information. Back to your original question about if the information creation is getting exploded, and it's only going to get, you know, larger, and our attention span is only going to shrink, proportionately speaking. Because of that, I think visualization plays a fundamental role in education and how people consume information. And I was thinking about the Corona tracker. That's been, look, in many ways, it's been life-saving, you know, huge array of fragmented data sets organized and synthesized that people are looking at it. You know, it's simplified and visualized in a very simplistic way, thinking about the audience. It is allowing people to say where their country is. You know, it could be a hope of optimism or pessimism day to day. It could also be, you know, for the countries and the businesses, they are making trade and travel decisions based on the trending data. You know, it doesn't get more complicated than that, because historically, data visualization has had this reputation. It's, you know, gauges and dashboards. It's complex for someone to consume. It's actually quite the opposite. How do you distill it? How do you make it so simple? If I may, I'll share a few specific examples that caught my attention. Two specific ones on micro and maybe two on macro. The micro one is I saw this BMW ad, a campaign a few years ago. And it was a, you know, very clever marketing, and they were listing out the 3 Series model, and they only had two attributes on the page. One was 0 to 60, number of seconds to get to 0 to 60. And right next to that, it was the price. So you had 5 choices on a page. It said 0 to 60, you can get there in 7 seconds, and the most expensive car will get there in 4.5 seconds. And the price was $35,000 to $50,000. And what's interesting about it was clever marketing, but actually it's a great data visualization example.
Absolutely.
If you're looking to make a purchase, and they cut through all the clutter and said, if you're a BMW driver, you care about a lot of things, but what you really care about is 0 to 60. And they figured out the segment, and they were playing it to, yeah, I don't mind paying 10,000 more because I'll get an extra second. Not that that makes any difference, but it just shows how well they've understood the psychology and used data to visualize it. The other personal example is, you know, most of the airlines have gotten very good at visualizing things and saying, look, you got 3 more flights to take if you want to upgrade to silver or gold. And psychologically, they're just nudging you in the direction to drive the right business outcome, because you would do that. And I thought that was very clever. On a macro level, this could be quite inspiring. There's a website called informationisbeautiful.net. And this is, you know, a bunch of journalists, data journalists, that are curating world's information and building beautiful, meaningful, purposeful visualization. And when you see that website, you know, I'm convinced the future education model is going to follow more of visualization rather than textual, providing just data for sake of data. And Economist, as an example, many, many publications are doing it. Economist used to do this year in a page as a big snapshot of all the events that happen in a year. It's very popular. Now they've actually taken that and starting to crystallize, how do you make that available on Instagram? How do you make it available on different channels? So they have to come up with very simple, clever visualization, because you only have 3 seconds before someone can swipe. So which means you have to, you know, deliver that information in a very crystallized way. The simplicity of the visualization actually highlights the complexity underneath on how well you hide it. So it's quite relevant to what you're doing here, Rajiv. So congratulations to you and your team on, you know, stepping into visualization, because I don't think it's a sideshow. It's absolutely going to become the central show of how people learn, synthesize, and make decisions in the future.
Thank you, Max. Really awesome insights. And if I may, I just have one follow-up question to what you just mentioned. So while we focus a lot about what individuals can do to become data literate and so on, is there an organizational element as well in terms of establishing the right culture or fostering the right environment where data literacy can flourish? Is there any organizational aspect that you can touch upon? Things that need to be done right before data can really come to the center stage?
Yeah, you know, a friend of mine was saying the other day, you know, you can learn about an organization if you learn how decisions get made, you know? So when you talk about culture, it's ultimately understanding how decisions get made. If they are preferences and opinions, stronger opinions versus, you know, they can actually be based on data, that's a huge shift. So at an organization level, it's actually, if you can influence the decision-making process to be more data-driven, and there are a few that do this exceptionally well, you know, that would create the culture for people to learn to collect more, capture more, and start to influence data-driven decision-making, which is a journey, right? This isn't a three-month effort. This is a commitment that you need to get into. The challenge here, Rajiv, is as much as we say it's individual versus company, well, you know, companies made of individuals. And the biggest challenge is, you know, among many biases, the biggest bias we all have is confirmation. So we actively seek out information that already confirms our own bias. So the biggest roadblock in becoming data-driven is you seek out information that you already know or you believe in, which other companies exploited. So as you are influencing your culture, you have to be conscious of the confirmation bias and figure out how do you change the decision-making in a company. If you understand it, if you rewire it, it definitely creates a culture to be more data-driven.
Spot on. Thank you so much, Max, for those insights. I've always walked away with great insights. Every single time I've interacted with you, and this time is no exception. I hope the participants here also have taken away, you know, massive insights from your short Q&A here. Thank you for taking the time, Max. So on that note, I would like to introduce Kalyan to take this away and walk us through the data whiz simulation. Over to you, Kalyan.
Thanks, Rajiv. Thanks, Max, for the great insights. If you can just enable me the share access.
Yeah.
Okay, I hope the simulation is up and the screen is visible.
Yes, it is.
Great. Okay. So we'll move to the most awaited and the exciting part of the session, which is product launch. So what you see here is a brief agenda of what we will be discussing over the course of the next 15-20 minutes. So we'll give you a brief introduction of what this product is, what the data simulation product is, and what are the various outcomes that come out of it. We'll give you a walkthrough of the entire simulation, and then we'll jump into the report, and we'll finally end it with use cases. Basically, how do I take this product or consume this product, fit this in back in my organization's learning and development journey, right? So that's what we'll eventually move towards. So the simulation, the title is called Data Whiz. It's like a whiz kid who is good at data. That's the whole idea behind the name. Now, so the whole concept around the fact is that, so in this era of data explosion, right, one of the key skills that is effectively needed is around storytelling. And for effective storytelling, what you need is interpretation and visualization skills, the data interpretation and visualization skills. So that is what the simulation mainly focuses upon. And so the simulation basically puts the learners in a simulated environment where the various scenarios, challenges thrown at you, and your actions or your responses to these will effectively tell you have you been doing it in the right way? The background of this is basically tied back to all the basic principles and best practices of data visualization. And in terms of the outcomes, how does this eventually help from a business standpoint? Obviously, it's going to build in that visualization skills, right? And which can be part of that data-based decision-making or a data-driven culture scenario in any organization. And as a result, the effectiveness in terms of how you can convey this data or convey these insights back to any particular audience, be it your organization, board, or whatever, and which will eventually help in better decision-making. In fact, better, improved, and faster decision-making, I would say. So that's the whole outcome of how the simulation focuses on. Now, what are we talking about in the simulation, right? So the very basic four competencies or four concepts that we cover in the simulation. So there's data representation, which is nothing but around what is the most effective format of representing data, right? and most accurate way of representing data. That's data representation. Visual clarity, it's more around how does the visual be so comprehending and very easy that I can get an insight out of it very easily. That's the whole visual clarity. So basically relevant information coming very clearly and highlighting very clearly. Now the third aspect is data interpretation, which is it's basically trying to interpret what the data, as the name suggests. Can I draw correct inferences or conclusions from this data is what we are looking at data interpretation. And last but not the least is around insight building. This is how do you generate insights in a manner that basically is more clear, compelling, and also engaging to the end audience. So that's what these four primarily speak about. And as you see, each of those four concepts or competencies in turn have some subtopics that are covered in detail. Self-understood without getting into details of each of them. Let's say we just look at data representation, for example, styles and rules. These are some of the principles and the best practice of data visualization. Styles, very simply put it, what format do you use in what situation? Would a pie chart make sense? Would a line graph make sense? Or would a bar graph make sense? So those kind of questions are what styles cater to. Rules are around what are some of the standards that or the rules that you need to follow when you're basically adopting a certain style. A very trivial example would be in the case of a pie chart, very basic meaning is that the sum of the entire quadrants of the pie chart needs to be added up to a whole of 100%. So those kind of rules for every style. So accordingly, the various other subtopics that you can see around cluttering, reading graphs, all the way to information versus insight. The whole disparity between what is information, is information consumable, and what is insight, and how does that add value to a decision-making process. So that is what typically is covered in this entire simulation. With that, we'll jump into a quick demo of how the simulation functions. Just one second. Okay, so what you see on the screen now is the home screen of the Dataverse simulation that I've just introduced to. So every simulation methodology has three core elements to onboarding a user or a learner. So this is the introduction, which is the context or the story in which you're playing the simulation. Second is basically the role. What is that role that you're playing as part of this virtual environment? And last but not the least is about as part of your role and as part of the story that you're in that virtual environment, what are the objectives that you're tasked with? So this simulation, you're taking the role of a senior analyst called Alexa Axel, and a senior analyst from a sales point of view. So that is your role. What's the context? So there is this boutique store called True Fashion, and it's been pretty popular over the decades, but off late what's happened is the business has not been that great. There's some kind of a hiccups that are facing. And so the CEO of this True Fashion company has hired you and has put you as part of a certain task force. So this task force is a small team of individuals from various departments of the organization. And this task force has an objective that you need to figure out why this thing is happening. And you, as part of a senior analyst, your role in this particular task force is to analyze the data, come up with various insights, which the leadership team or eventually can find, or the your own task force team can actually make insights and find that useful, kind of stop this decline that's happening at the business level. So that's your core objective. The scenario is set in a virtual environment. So different task force being the virtual COVID scenario, there are a lot of people operating from different locations. So the whole simulation is, or the conversations are happening through chat messages, calls, or emails. So that's the context. Now, just before we jump into the simulation, okay, what are your core objectives from a simulation standpoint, right? Two core objectives that you are measuring is something called Vistar and something called Insightometer. So Vistar is nothing but, as it says, your basic ability to interpret and represent data in the most effective and accurate way. That is Vistar, where you get a rating out of on a scale of 1 to 5. The second one is the Insightometer, which is, are you able to come up with the right insights at the right time? And how effective are those, are accurate are those insights, or what talks, or is what something that gives you a score on Insightometer, which is measured on a scale of 100%. Okay, with that, we'll jump into the simulation. So the simulation, typically of any simulations that we build, we give a concrete tutorial around the onboarding so that the users spend minimal time while they're playing the core simulation. So what you see here is the onboarding tutorial. The simulation has a duration of about 40 minutes, but completely customizable or configurable based on the end audience. It always keeps showcasing you the two parameters or the two metrics that are being measured. There's also a leaderboard, wherein when you're playing in a batch of 50, 100, whatever the number is, you can, there's that social angle that comes in, a competitive angle. And pretty much everything else is the standard features that you would find in any unified inbox system. Mails from what you have, the star facility. With that, we jump into the core of the simulation. Like I said, the entire scenario's challenges are built around the story of True Fashion, a boutique outlet. And all the conversations are going to happen through emails and various call messages. So I'll take you through a few scenarios, and then we can wrap it up with the report as well. So there's just a welcome message, which is basically welcoming you to the whole organization. So this is one of the message. Like I mentioned, there's a call or a chat message that's coming up, which is dynamically coming up at different times. As you see, basically there's a brief conversation that happens around welcoming you to the whole organization. There's a certain scenario that's being thrown at you. So here you can see that Alina is asking you to help her with presenting a slide of quarter-wise trends in the sales of their footwear category. So pretty typical of how you get in an organization, you get a certain table of the entire data. So that is what Alina is presenting to you. And now she's asking your help in kind of representing this visually in a much better format, which is more consumable, right? So you can see a bunch of data of various variants of the products and what the sales volumes have been in Q1, Q2, Q3, and Q4. Now, we'll come to the aspect of what is Alina typically looking for here, right? Very trivial again. What is Alina looking for is basically to give your audience an overall picture of the product line. So every action or every decision you take here is eventually going to be added to your Insightometer and Vistar ratings, and also various data points that we cover at the end of the simulation. No, we've said that, and Alina says that's right. And now comes the question as to how do I represent this? So let's make this interactive, right? Okay, so the point is that Alina is asking you for an overall picture of the product line. So there are three options that you have: a simple graph, which is around the quarterly sales trends, a line graph, a 3D graph, a 3D line graph, and a stacked bar chart. So if I, let's pose it to the audience who's here. So what is the right option here? To represent an overall picture, like I said, of the product line sales.
Simple line graph.
Okay.
Yeah, line graph should be.
Right, very simple. Why do you think 3D graph is not applicable here? It's pretty much the same line graph that's being shown, right? So either you can put on chat or you can just unmute your mics and speak out on the mic as well. So why is 3D graph not what you say, a good one compared to a simple line graph?
3D is also a good one. I think both are the same, but yeah, 3D is a more good format for visualization.
Okay. So the majority I'm thinking is going with simple line graph here, as I see the chat windows as well. So we'll click line graph and we'll show you what exactly is happening post this, right? So this response comes up and Alina thinks that's the right thing in mind. And what has happened here? So with respect to the four concepts that we've covered, right, which is around data representation, the visual clarity, data interpretation, and insight building, what's the core thing that's happening here, which is around data representation? What is the best way to represent this data? If you look at the second aspect, which is visual clarity, the reason quarterly sage trends in a simple line graph is more effective than a 3D graph is because as the data increases, 3D graph starts to create a bit of a clutter, right? And that kind of creates a slight disruption, which is why for a simple data such as this, simple line graph is preferred, which is again tying back to the basic principles and best practice of data visualization. We'll take one more. We'll see how that be effective. So this is the other format of a scenario or a challenge that is thrown at you, where there's an email coming to you. As you can see, an email coming from Alina again, which is saying, I need you to pick your brains. I need to show trends across a specific time frame, sales in a particular region over the past few months. That's the scenario that she's asking for and telling us, how can you help me in representing this? Standard unified inbox messaging system features, like I mentioned, there's a reply to this. And then it gives you certain options. What among these would be the best ones to choose? As you can see, there is one thing which is a trend, which is a line graph. There's a pie chart. And there's also a scatter plot, which is again showcasing a trend. All the ones showcasing across the months, which is what Alina specifically asked for. Again, throwing it back to the audience, what do you think is the best option here, the best representation?
Pie chart.
Okay. Anyone else?
Line graph.
Okay.
I think the line graph is the best.
Perfect. That's the right one. Why is it so? Because what Alina is asking here is basically for a trend, and trend implies a time series or linear data, a trend of the sales over a span of all the previous months, right? Over the last 1 year, Jan to December. So pie doesn't give you a series. It doesn't even tell you what the trend is clearly. Line is simply telling you what the trend is. Now, so even scatterplot is typically showing you the trend, right? Why do you think scatterplot isn't the right answer?
The scatter is about actually looking at how the data points get bunched up, you know? So this is not so much, you're not really looking at a bunching of any information. You're really looking at month on month. There's one data point every month. So there is no scatter over there,
right? Perfect. Perfectly put it, right? Just to see what happens if we select scatter, right? Let's do this. So you're choosing that specific representation and you're saying, I'm sending this email to Alina. What's the response that you're getting? I gave this a try, but it looks empty. And I'm afraid when I put this on a big screen, so obviously when you put on a big screen, the points might not be clear. And exactly like what you just heard, the clear representation is when you showcase that clear trend, and which is not giving me any cognitive headache of trying to figure out how that trend is. It's clearly giving me a line. So line graph in this sense is the best option here. And like you see, as we move towards various other scenarios, right, you can see this insightometer also kind of moving forward. We'll just take one last scenario and then we can probably move towards the other two options, which are around how do we consume this and what is the report coming up. Now here, there's this new person called Ambaji, the director of sales, asking you, can you turn last year's monthly sales figures for all our channels, the channels we're doing the sales, into a nice clean graph? That's the scenario that she's throwing at you. The options you have again is you have a spider graph, really showing this. You have a line graph again, which is showing the trends of all the three channels. You have a bar charts, and then you also have a stacked bar charts, histogram and a stacked bar charts. Again, one last one to the audience and then we'll jump in. What is the right answer here?
A stack diagram is a good indication, but so is a bar. So either one of the last two.
Okay. So what's happening is, it's pretty clear that spider is ruled out, right? Because we are looking at a trend of the last year's monthly sales. So spider is ruled out. It's not going to give you a trend. If you look at all the other three, so line is pretty clear. The bar and the histograms, you can even here, you can see that you can still figure out the trend here. So what's happening for this channel? Same here. You can still figure out here what's the trend here. But do we need that another level of complication in trying to figure out the trend? Because all that I want is a trend simply. That's what Ambajit has asked us for. So a simple trend, which is on a line graph, which is clearly talking about what this trend is over the years, and also clearly showcasing that direct channel sales is much lower than a retail sales compared to an online one. So very simply put it, 2, 3, and 4 all right, but 2 visual clarity wise is the most effective, which is why this becomes the right option in this case.
Just add a thought there. Sure. What happens when now in here, obviously all the numbers are such that the lines are not overlapping. Correct. If the lines were overlapping, then would a bar chart have made more sense?
Yeah, the slight, so there are those cases when there could be, again, depends on how many overlaps you're having. In that case, maybe a stark bar chart would be slightly more effective. In this scenario, given that the curves are this way, the effective one would be a line graph. So obviously what you see here at a very basic level, right? And we are looking at only about 3 to 4 scenarios. So as you progress towards the course of the simulation, you'll have tons of scenarios, almost close to 30 plus scenarios, challenges that are thrown at you. And the difficulty and the complexity levels will start to increase to another completely different dimension. Then various concepts like we discussed, all that we just spoke about is only data representation and visual clarity. So then the insight building and the data interpretation kind of things kick in as you progress through this in a linear fashion. So you're firstly at a representation stage, you will eventually lead to the insight building stage at the end of it. So again, over a course of almost 30 plus emails or scenarios will be thrown at you in a span of 40 minutes. You'll have to choose the right options accordingly, the right scenarios, and that will have an impact on your parameters that are getting measured here. Good. Any questions before I quickly jump into the report? Any questions on the simulation front?
So are these cases fixed or are these cases customizable? In the sense, what I see in this screen is all sales related scenarios. So if you want to customize it to a particular function or, you know, some specific kind of cases, are these customizable?
Yes, they're absolutely. So the content entirely, the underlying principles we can keep it the same, which is the 4 concepts. The entire customization on with respect to the content that you see on the face of it, all these emails, they're completely customizable. So you can create a scenario for something that works for your organization as well or an industry.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, great. So with that, I'll just jump into the last couple of slides that we have.
Kalyan, good question. Pooja this side. Hello.
Yes, Pooja.
Yeah. Regarding the scenarios that you have told about, apart from that, if somewhere for this particular role, if there has to be some creation or something, can that be done? Let's say these were like scenarios which was put up through mails. Okay. Will there be any situation or a case where the individual or the participant will have to kind of create those graphs or something as per the question or something?
Not on this. So typically it's because creation of graph becomes a little bit of a challenge. So what we can do is we can increase the number of options. We can make it a lot more complicated. Because effectively it's not around the execution that we are focusing. Like how do you create these graphs, which is more into the tools. We are focusing on the actual skills, which is, do I know even what graph should I use effectively? So the aspect of how do I create the graph is not something that we cover in this solution. Hope that answered your question, Pooja.
Yeah, yes.
Okay, quickly moving to, like I said, right, the various, all of the simulations, something that we pride very highly on is the background algorithms and the data points that we capture. So other than the 2 core parameters, which is around the VizStar and the Insightometer, we provide these 4 competencies or concepts that we spoke about. So every option or every challenge that is thrown at you, how you're answering the challenge, how you're responding to the challenge, gets added to these 4 concepts or competencies. That's where you get a score of. And all our simulations have concepts of competencies measured on a scale of 0 to 10. As the number of people or the number of users consuming this particular product increase, we constantly keep benchmarking our data, which means, let's say you play the simulation today and you get an 8, and you play the same simulation after 1 year, there's a chance you might get a 6 because there have been another 10,000 users have played, and for them, they seem to be scoring pretty highly in the simulation. So very, very dynamically, we benchmark it. As you can see, detailed inputs that's given about what your score is. And one of the interesting aspects of all our reports is we give you dynamic insights based on how you have performed. So this insight that you see here is a dynamic one, depending on how you actually perform in the simulation. So these are different for different people. Now, quickly on the last aspect. So now that we understood what the simulation is, how do I consume this? What are the various use cases that I can fit this product in our organization? Firstly, a data literacy journey. Let's say your organization is already on a data literacy journey path, and you think this is one of the critical capability that needs to be built in. Dataverse is something that can easily fit into that scenario. Secondly, like Max was pointing out earlier, typical data analytics solutions where you have proper data analysts trying to just analyze data, which is thrown at them, and something that they have to take back to whoever that decision maker is to represent the data in an effective way and for faster decision making. That is where it can fit in. Sales and marketing training, pretty self-understood, because they'll be breathing in and out data and kind of trying to understand from that data, right? Numbers-wise, sales-wise, which is something our simulation is also, story is also built upon. Digital readiness training for managers, something we call digital quotient, for managers who are trying to communicate data in a very effective way, in a data-driven way, as part of a data-driven culture that exists in an organization. Last but not the least is basically for effectiveness of presentations from a senior leader standpoint, either when they're doing making some decisions or trying to inform the board, influence stakeholders for better decision making. So those are some of the various use cases the simulation can fit into very seamlessly. Just to give an idea quickly on, okay, what we spoke about as a use case, if you have to put this product as part of an entire journey, which is showcasing one sample journey that it can fit into. We can start with a virtual instructor-led session, which is talking about the whole process of how do you make decisions, what are the various analysis of data that is available. Then we'll jump into some self-paced learning courses. This is mostly around the pre-read material that will make the simulation a lot more effective for them. Then we jump into a simulation, which is something that you've seen now. The simulation will have a pre and a post, a debrief, the entire simulation and the report. And then you can end up with something called a sense-making leadership. This is around how do I make sense of the data, and how do you understand the mindset and skills of a leader who's involved in making sense of this data. Right? So this is just a sample journey to showcase how we can build a certain journey for your organization with respect to how whatever the need that would be in your organization or the focus in your organization would be. More like a transformational journey that we can work with you guys as well. So with that, we come to the end of the simulation walkthrough. Any questions, I'll open the stage for Rajiv also to join, and we'll be happy to take any questions that you have.
I hope you enjoyed the walkthrough of the simulation. Just to step back a little bit, in the introduction, I spoke about leading now and leading next. This product falls under the leading next category. So this is a bunch of capabilities that we are trying to build for individuals, managers, leaders, to become proficient in the digital age. So in this category, we already have other products like design thinking, agile. Now we've added this as well. And so our pursuit continues in terms of pushing the boundaries of what people need to be knowing in the digital age. So I hope this was interesting and useful. Please feel free to ask us questions in terms of how this can be deployed.
Kalyan, Manoj here. This was an interesting simulation. And I like the options that were presented and the kind of justification you were giving for why pie versus a line graph or bar chart, right? I like those. Just wondering, like with other simulations, I understand there's a pre and post, and at the post we do the debrief for the how the participants performed. But this being the one on visualization, wherein actually people are going to see how data is represented and they make a right or a wrong decision, is there a possibility to probably give the feedback instantaneously with each question? As to, let's say, I submit a response, because these are so many visual charts, right? And the way you were explaining with one or two examples that you showed us, it would be really helpful if those explanations come right away and the last debrief can be a little quicker than maybe post the simulation, 40 minutes.
Great. I think that's a good question, Manoj. So maybe we didn't get a chance to showcase all the other challenges that are thrown at you, right? So there is a certain response and the feedback that comes through, like when we choose a scatter plot, does tell you why it doesn't work. So we do give for every response a small explanation about why it is working or why it is not working. And we take this back into the debrief to cover that in a lot more detail. But for every question, there is a response. And it's a good point. We can always look at kind of detailing that response even further if needed. But just to answer that question, yes, we do have some response. And it also gets covered in the debrief in detail.
Well, that's very useful then, because that's the instant, because the images are right in front of you. And then that feedback will help. Unlike in other simulations wherein you can hold.
It's more learning and reflect.
Hold on till the end.
Yeah. So there is some feedback definitely that goes on.
Thank you.
Any other questions, any queries as such with respect to how the product works, the use cases? So we will have a follow-up after this where our team will reach out to you. And if guys who are actually interested can actually reach out to us.
It's a quick poll. If you're interested in talking to one of us, a specialist from Knowlescape, to see how we can help you build data visualization skills in your organization, just say yes on the chat window or one on the chat window. But if you think this is not really something that you're looking at, say no thanks. That's completely understandable. This will help us, reaching out to you and solving some of the issues that you may be facing in building some future skills in your organization.
I just had one question, Rajiv, Seema here.
Yes, Seema.
Yeah, so this is a good simulation. My question is this, where are you pegging this? Is this at a basic entry, introductory kind of a level, or is it for existing, analysts who are already there in the role of data analysts, and they just want to get better? So,
yeah, this is more for the non-specialists, Seema. So for specialists, obviously, this will come across as...
That's what I thought.
This is for the others who are dealing with data, but and they are probably making decisions on data, like what I mentioned earlier, right? There are three parts to it. One is data, we all deal with it. Decisions we do make. But the in-between part of insight generation and visualization requires a lot more practice. So that's where we are introducing the product. It's more for... the non-specialists than the specialists in this case.
Okay, thanks.
Sure. All right, so we are already at the top of the hour. I'd like to quickly thank all of you for taking time out and participating in this product launch. It really means a lot to us. A lot of effort has gone into this product. Thanks, Kalyan, Nivedita, SR, everybody who has contributed to the product, Amrita. I can't name everybody on this call, but thank you, Nolis, for getting this done. It's an important problem to be solved for managers and leaders in organizations. So thank you so much for that. And thank you, everybody, for taking the time. We'll be in touch.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks. Bye.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Bye.